Copper. It's a metal. But why is it a different color to all of the other metals? Why is it a solid at room temperature? Why is it orange as a metal, but blue when put into solution? Why is it used in gardening? And why, most of all, is it so good at preventing pregnancy? Some of these questions I know the answers to. Recently on the internet, I've found a few pretty cool projects that people have done involving copper and a bit of electrochemistry with copper. Most people, I think, are familiar with electroplating with copper. Copper is one of the easiest metals to actually electroplate with. And then some people might also be aware that if you electroplate with copper using a copper sulfate solution for long enough, you will start to build up copper dendrites on your electrode. So instead of just coating your electrode with copper, you eventually get these kind of tree-like growths that look really cool. Anyway, in my search online, I found a few people who have done a very similar experiment, but instead of running a high enough current to get big copper dendrites in a very short amount of time, they have done a very, very slow electroplating process of copper in order to get copper to grow in a very, very crystalline manner. Now, I really like the idea of having a crystalline form of a metal. And while I'm not the biggest fan of plating metals, it is still electrochemistry, and I am a big fan of electrochemistry, so it doesn't sound that hard to do, so I feel like we should just have a go at copying what these other people have done. Our experiment will basically just involve the electrolysis of a copper sulfate solution with copper electrodes. This is a very, very common way to just transfer copper from one electrode, the anode, to the other. It will oxidize on the anode to produce copper 2 plus ions, and on the cathode, copper 2 plus ions will be reduced back to copper metal. This is kind of the reason I'm not really the biggest fan of metal plating. It's kind of just dissolving a metal on one end and then bringing it back on the other electrode. It's not really all that interesting, and hence why I haven't done much of it on the channel so far. Now, since the goal is to electrolyze our copper sulfate solution to give us crystalline copper instead of dendritic copper, we really need to work hard to build a cell and run it in the right way such that dendrite formation is strongly inhibited. Now, normally, the formation of dendrites is favorable because as a dendrite forms, the tip of the dendrite is closer to the other electrode, and hence current is simply more likely to flow through the end of that dendrite instead of the sides or the back, because overall that's the path of least resistance in the cell. A really good way to mitigate this effect is to increase the distance between our two electrodes, because then on the cathode, if a dendrite were to form, there's really not all that much relative difference between the resistance of going through the end of the dendrite or through the back of the dendrite. Normally, that would involve building a massive cell and using a lot of copper sulfate solution to build it. You can imagine if we wanted things maybe a meter apart, that would normally involve having a bucket that's like a meter wide full of copper sulfate solution and then electrodes on either side. Instead, that is why we have built this kind of monstrosity of a contraption. Basically, this is a way to increase the distance between the electrodes without building a really, really massive cell. Each container gets its own electrode, and then these tubes fill up with the solution, and then effectively we have a very low volume cell, but we are still able to get this kind of really long distance between one electrode to the next. Additionally, if I kind of lean this towards you, you can see that we've kind of got six tubes going into and out of each of our two containers. And this is just to keep the electric field kind of even when we go to put our electrodes in each one. Hopefully that's clear how this is all going to work. And I'm sure you can tell that we are going to fill our containers with a whole bunch of copper sulfate solution. Now, one other thing we need to do to favor the formation of crystals over dendrites is to make sure that we are working with a very, very low current or a low current density. The slower we plate our copper, the more likely the atoms are to kind of just fall into the naturally structured shape of the crystal. And to show you my setup for that, you can see here, first of all, we have 5 volts. Hopefully you can still see the multimeter screen. And to make sure that we always get about a milliamp, which I think is a pretty good current in order to get the copper to grow slow enough to form the crystalline shape, but fast enough that the reaction actually happens, I'm going to introduce this circuit component. This is a voltage regulator that I have soldered a resistor onto in order to turn it into a current regulator. Now, due to the way that this semiconductor works, I have attached this resistor with the correct value to give us approximately 1 milliamp, as I was saying before. So if we attach this part of the circuit onto the end of our positive lead for our 5 volts, and if we now measure the current that we're going to get from this thing, you can see that we get about 1.3 milliamps. And that genuinely should be all there is to it. We have our electrodes in there. This is the cathode. This is the single wire that will grow our nice copper crystals, hopefully. Anyway, making our electrical connection right here should allow 1 milliamp to flow through the cell. And then the plan from here is to just wait a month or so for our copper crystals to grow, if they do grow. About 60 days later, this is where we are. I have finished running the cell, not really by choice. I wanted to run it for 3 months, but the power to the lab disconnected yesterday. And I'm pretty sure that having the crystal just sitting in the solution without constantly being cathodically protected by the potential that we're applying is possibly not good for continued crystal growth. So I'm going to stop it right here. We have copper crystals in there. I can kind of see them through the container, but it will be nice to take it out and actually have a look. I haven't seen them in the last 60 days. They've just been growing in there and I haven't touched them. So I guess it's time to disassemble the cell. To be honest, a little bit underwhelming for 2 months of work. I was expecting the copper crystals to be a little bit bigger, as in the facets would be visible macroscopically. Instead, we do have somewhat crystalline copper, it looks like, but I don't know, the crystals are very small and it's not quite as striking as I was expecting. Anyway, no reason to complain. I wasn't exactly working hard over these 2 months to make this crystal. So anyway, I guess it's time to wash our copper deposit and then maybe seal it in an ampule to make sure that it doesn't ever oxidize. All right, yeah, ampuling. I mean, it looks cool in an ampule, but didn't really protect it from oxidation. I should have really ampuled it under nitrogen or argon, but that was a little bit beyond my capabilities. It is still somewhat crystalline, and I was able to obtain some close-up shots before ampuling the thing. But overall, not really the crystals that I was looking for when I started this project. I'm sure someone in the comments will tell me what I did wrong. It's not that bad, but maybe I should have acidified the copper sulfate solution, something like that. But either way, I think we're done. We got a kind of cool looking piece of copper out of this. It wasn't much work to do. So I think we'll save our effort for better projects in the future. It's not like every video can be all that exciting, so guess I'll see you later.